Amen. Are you glad to be in God's house today? Amen. Good crowd this morning. And how many of you enjoyed the sunshine outside? It's nice. It's supposed to be warmer even this coming week. And so I'm assuming the torrential apocalyptic snow season of 2024 is about over. I'm not really sure how we survived it. Were you? At least in my neck of the woods in Roanoke, we didn't get that much. But it was still a lot more than we had last year. But then again, we've seen some big snows in March. So we'll see what happens. We're glad you're here. Hey, let me put a plug in for the revival, and our brother's already done a phenomenal job of that. But, you know, the service that you choose not to attend may be the one that God wants to do a work in your heart. Now, that doesn't mean that God can't bypass that and do what he wants to do when he wants to do it, because he can. But why don't you try to be here? If your health and work schedule will allow you to do that, then try your best to come and invite some folks out. We'll be giving the gospel every single night, Lord willing. And even one night in particular, we will emphasize the gospel. We'll let you know which one is that. But if you got lost folks in your family, friends, co-workers, neighbors, invite them out. But let me also say this. This is a revival meeting. Why don't you invite that Christian brother or sister who hasn't been in church for the last 10, 15 years? Maybe you know of people that haven't darkened the doorsteps of Pine Grove Missionary Baptist, who, if you were to ask them where are they a member, they would name this church. Why don't you invite them out? Maybe there's somebody that got bitter or mad at God or the people of God who needs to be back in church. So, Brother Brad, they won't come. Well, I can guarantee you this, they won't come if you won't ask them. We never know until we ask, until we invite. And you allow the Word of God, the Spirit of God through the Word of God to do the work of God in their lives. And that'll happen. Amen. Do you believe that? If you don't, we might as well stay home. And we believe in the power of the Word of God so very much. Thank you for letting me be here today. Hope you won't be tired of me by the time this is all done. And trust that also the process of you finding a pastor is going according to the Lord's will. And you want God's man and God's timing. And when that happens, God's will be accomplished. And it'll be a wonderful thing. God has got great things in store for Pine Grove Missionary Baptist as he tarries his coming. And appreciate the leadership of Brother Jerry. Pastor Jerry Martin for all, probably 12 years, brother. Thank you for his leadership and his friendship. And I have made dear, lifelong friends in he and Miss Rita. And I appreciate them so very much. And although they're both years old, they don't act like it. They don't act like it. And you need to hang around them and joke and cut up, and you'll feel younger when you get away from them. And so we're glad for that. Take your Bible this morning, if you will, and turn to Psalm chapter 133. Psalm 133. I want to go ahead and tell you, I hope you'll come back tonight or you won't get the second part of this. It's a two-parter, and I'm not going to tell you what tonight's all about, so you got to come back to find out. Let me say that I believe that what we want to discuss this morning is of the utmost importance. First of all, if it's in God's Word, it's important. If God chose to write it down through His Holy Spirit and have men of God record it in His words, then that tells me it's important. Somebody once said, never get bogged down or bored with the details of God's Word, because they're there for a reason. And here in the book of Psalm, we find a word used that is misused in today's church over and over and over again. But it's a word that you and I need to revisit and to make sure we understand what it means from God's perspective, and especially during this time in Pine Grove Missionary Baptist's transitional period. You are in between pastors and seeking God's leadership. And Satan would love nothing more than to throw his wrench into the gears and mess up the whole engine. Jesus looked at Peter one time, Brother J.W., and said, the Satan desires to sift you as wheat. And I want to tell you what, the devil wants to sift this church. He doesn't want a gospel witness here in Linside, West Virginia. He doesn't want God's people getting along as they come to church and attempt to serve him as a unit before the Lord. He wants dissension. He wants bickering.
He wants fighting and fussing and fuming. Have you heard the story about the Christian who was stranded on a deserted island? He was a modern-day Robinson Crusoe. He lived off of coconuts and whatever FedEx boxes was washed by his way, all right? If you've seen Castaway, you'll get that reference, okay? He sat there and he decided that on this island he would talk to the Lord and try to remain close to him, which he tried to do. 7 years went past and a ship came and saw him and rescued him. As they came to the island, they noticed that there were three huts on the island. As they went to each hut, they said to him, "Well, brother, what's this hut here?" He said, "Oh, that's my home. That's where I lived. I found branches and I found, vines and things of that nature, and I made me a sturdy dwelling place, and I've lived there for the last 7 years." Then they came to a middle hut, and it had a cross on the front of it designed from some vines and looked similar to his house. He said, "What's this?" He said, "Oh, this is my church. This is where I go and worship the Lord twice on Sunday and on Wednesday night too, because I'm a good Baptist." And then there was a third hut, and it was kind of falling down. It was dilapidated, and a partial cross was there. And they said, "Well, what's this hut here?" He said, "Oh, that's where I used to go to church." Now, isn't that sad? But do you know we fuss and we fight and we fume over ridiculous things that don't amount to a hill of beans in light of eternity? And friends, when we are not one in Christ in the same direction with the same spirit and the same attitude, the devil licks his lips and wrings his hands in glee because he has us right where he wants us. Friend, this morning we're talking about the importance of biblical unity. Here in Psalm 133, verse 1, look what the psalmist says. Now remember, this is Old Testament. The church had not even been founded yet. But look what he says. Under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, David says this: "Behold, how good." The word means better. It means agreeable. It means pleasant. It means beneficial. "Behold, how good and how pleasant, beautiful, precious it is for brethren to dwell together in unity." Isn't that a pretty verse? But not only is it a beautiful verse, but it's a beautiful truth. That when God's people are living as one, they're in agreement with one another. It's a beautiful thing. And let's be honest, folks. Most of our churches today, a lot of them anyway, exist not organically, but they exist because somebody got mad at somebody else and went down the road and started a new work. Friends, that's not the way it ought to be. Now listen, sometimes if there's false doctrine being taught or there's immorality being covered up in the church or there's a real issue where people need to leave and go somewhere else where the truth is being taught and lived, then that needs to happen. But there's a lot of times that splits and arguments take place and brothers and sisters won't talk to each other in Christ for decades because of it. Do you know that we're not in competition today? Do you know that we're on the same team? When we get to heaven and we are exposed to the inner chambers of heaven and we see what's going on, whatever that is, God's the only one that knows for sure, and we walk in and we see what's going in, do you know there's not going to be a Baptist compartment and a Lutheran and a Nazarene and a non-denominational and yada, yada, yada? You know the only people in heaven are Christians. People who have repented of their sin, realized that they're sinners, and believe that Jesus died and was buried and rose again. Those are the people that are in heaven. Now, I'm not suggesting this morning that we should tear down denominational walls. I'm not suggesting today that there aren't things that we as Baptists believe according to the Word of God that other people don't teach and preach that they should.
But what I'm saying is, where has the unity gone? I want to talk to you about the importance of unity this morning. Why don't you pray with me? Father, thank you for your word today. Thank you that you are a unified God, that there's perfect harmony between God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And Lord, that is your will for the church, that we be unified, not compromisers, not water-downers of the gospel, not people who throw out doctrine in favor of numbers, not people that substitute the gospel with gimmicks, but people who walk together in love and in agreement, headed the same direction. Father, that's your will. We don't have to pray about that. We don't have to seek a sign from the stars. It's in your word. Would you help us to be unified? Lord, I'm thankful that probably for the most part here at Pine Grove Missionary Baptist Church, there is a spirit of unity. But I pray if there be any roots, any seeds of disunity, of selfish agenda, of methodology that's not according to your word, that you would eradicate that in this local church here this morning. Lord, we can never receive revival if we're not unified to seek it. So I pray that you would eliminate whatever personal sin is in the way of that unity and that revival this morning. If there's somebody here in our service, or maybe someone listening to the live stream, who does not know Jesus Christ as Savior, then Lord, it's the heart's prayer of every believer today that that individual would be saved, that you'd convince them that you're the way, the truth, and the life, and that they're sinners, and that there's no way they can be saved on their own, but they must believe in what Jesus did on the cross and receive him by faith as Lord and Savior. Would you save that person today who's not saved, or those individuals who may not be? Father, as always, we claim Isaiah 55:11 that says that your word works. It doesn't return to you void. It prospers in the purpose for which you send it. We trust that today. We also claim Romans 10:17, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. You produce faith in the hearts of those who hear your word. Lord, help me to say what's pleasing to you. Give my voice strength today. Bind the devil, as he most assuredly does not want this message preached. And we'll give you the honor and glory for it. And all of God's people said, amen. Hey, we're talking about the importance of unity this morning. And the first thing that I want you to see today is a call for unity. Will you take your Bible and turn to John chapter 17, please? John 17. Do you know that the only two people in this world that you know for absolute certainty that prays for you is yourself and God? Hey, if you say, Brother Barry, would you please pray for me? I try to do it right then and there so I don't forget and make sure that I keep my word to somebody that asks. That's what we ought to do. But the only two individuals in this world that you know for sure prays for you is yourself and God himself. You know, the Bible says in Romans 8 that the Holy Spirit of God brings utterings and groanings before our Lord and translates our prayers before him in a way that is pleasing to him. We don't really know how to pray as we ought, but the Holy Spirit of God helps us. But here in John 17, where we find the true Lord's Prayer, where Jesus is communicating with God the Father, not long before he's about to go to the cross for you and for me, we find it's interesting that Christ not only prays for the apostles, the immediate 12 that surround him, or 11, because Judas had already gone to betray him by now, but he also prays for you and for me. Do you know that Jesus prayed for us even before he died for us? There's an old Southern gospel song that says, when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. And here in John 17, I want you to see some verses as we talk about this idea of unity this morning. We're in John 17, look at verse 20. Jesus says this to God the Father. He says, neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word. Friend, do you know that you eventually got the gospel because of the apostles? One way or the other, when that church started in Jerusalem
As they began to obey the Great Commission, there was Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and unto what? The uttermost parts of the world. And eventually, centuries later, you would receive the gospel right here in the United States of America. But it started with the great gospel dispersion and the persecution of the early church in the book of Acts. And Jesus said, I pray for those which shall be the heirs of salvation, shall get saved. Friend, that's you and me. So you know what? As you read this verse, it better grab your attention because Jesus is speaking to you and to me. And here's what he prays for in verse 21. That they all may be, what's the next word in your Bible? One. As thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be, what's the word? One in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. 1 John 5:7 is a verse in Scripture that proves the doctrine of the Trinity. If you have a Bible here this morning that casts doubt on that passage and has a note in the margin that says, many of the older manuscripts do not include this verse in the Bible, why don't you get rid of that Bible and get you a better one? 1 John 5:7 says this, there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, which by the way, that's Jesus himself. John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. Jesus said in John 10:30, I and my Father are one. Aren't you glad we don't have a disunified Godhead? Aren't you glad God the Father doesn't bicker with God the Son, who argues with God the Spirit? By the way, if that was true, he wouldn't be God and we would all be in trouble, wouldn't we? There's perfect harmony. Even when Jesus died for my sin and yours, everybody knew his role and there was perfect harmony there. Even as God the Father had to turn his back on his own Son, as Jesus became sin for you and for me, there was perfect harmony in accomplishing the redemption of mankind. They've never had a bickering. They've never had a disagreement. They've never had an argument. So, Brother Barry, are you telling us we're supposed to be perfect? Absolutely not. Do people bicker in church? People get mad in church? People argue? Do you ever disagree with the preacher? Oh, mercy. Jesus prayed. It was a call to unity. Number one, we see Jesus' prayer, but we're going to move on from there. Take your Bible and turn to 1 Corinthians 12. Not only do we see Jesus' prayer, I want you to see the Apostle Paul's pronouncement. 1 Corinthians chapter number 12. He's comparing the body of Christ to a human body. By the way, when's the last time you and I thank God for all of our fingers and toes? Literally. When's the last time we thank God for two arms and two legs and two lungs and a piece of a kidney if you're me? It's working. What's the time you thank God for your health? We can put one foot in front of the other one. We take it for granted, don't we? Paul compares the human body to the spiritual body we are in Christ. And by the way, I want to clear up a misconception. Each individual local church is not a separate body. We are all one body in Christ. Amen. And 1 Corinthians 12 says we are members in particular, which means each local assembly, the believers in that assembly, they make up part of the body. And so really when we pray and say, Lord, bless this body here tonight, that's actually not a biblical statement. We're part of the body of Christ. And the toes are not more important than the fingers. And the ears are important as the eyes, as the nose, and so on and so forth. Every part is important to make a cohesive whole. You know this morning that if your knee is killing you, all the concentration in your body is on that knee. It doesn't matter how great your right hand feels. If that left knee is hurting you as woe as me, and there's no relief in your life and your body until that left knee pain lets up, right? That's where it focuses on. I'll joke, when I'm not traveling in meetings, I'll substitute teach at a Christian school, and sometimes I'll joke with the kids, and they'll say, my foot's hurting or my hand's hurting. I say, listen,
If you'll let me walk up to you and smash your foot with all of my might, you'll forget all about your sore hand. And they look at me like, it's not very funny, Mr. Daniel. That was funny to me. Don't matter if you think it's funny or not. Sit down. Paul says this in 1 Corinthians 12. He said, we're members in particular. Look what he says, starting in verse number 23. And those members of the body, which we think to be less honorable, by the way, hero worship has no place in the church. Don't you worship this preacher. You worship the Lord. Amen. Whoever he brings as your pastor, he's not to be worshiped. He's a man subject to like passions as any other man. He's a sinner saved by grace as any other man. Don't put him on a pedestal. He'll never be able to attain to it. He'll never be able to reach that hero status because the only hero we have is Jesus himself. So Paul says, upon these we bestow more abundant honor, and our uncomely parts have more abundant comeliness. For our comely parts have no need, but God hath tempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which lacked. Verse 25, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care one for another. The word schism means division. Just listen to the word, schism. It's not a very pleasant word to say, is it? Paul said we need to recognize this thing called the body as a whole so that we don't have divisions among us. Now, why does it matter? Why is it a big deal if we fuss and fume and fight? Why is it a big deal if 40% of the church is on fire for God, but 60% is carnal and worldly and doesn't care? Why does that matter? Well, Jesus made it clear. We just read in John 17. He said, Lord, that they may be one so that the world will believe that you sent me. Amen. You know what, friends? I want to tell you today, the church is sending a mixed message to the world. Amen. Somebody once said this, and I wrote this quote down in one of my Bibles. Somebody once said that a Christian is somebody who asks God to forgive him for what he did on Saturday and what he's going to do on Monday. Lord, help us. And the world looks at that mess and says, listen, you claim that your relationship with Jesus is better than my religion, is better than my list of regulations, but you fight, fuss, and fume and argue. You're on the bar on Saturday, on the church house on Sunday. You're going to the ungodly concerts on Friday and singing Jesus music on Sunday. What's the difference between you and me? And we're not unified. That's what happens. Jesus said in John, by all this shall men know that you're my disciples, that you love one another. We get mad if the preacher stands up for what's right in church. Come on now. Preacher says, we shouldn't go this direction. Doesn't please God. Well, I don't like that. I don't agree with that. That's not the way that's always been done here at Pine Grove Missionary Baptist Church. Well, God forgive me, but maybe it's been done wrong here at Pine Grove Missionary Baptist Church. Tradition doesn't always equate truth. Man, if I really want to get run out of here on a rail, then the whole time I'm here for revival, preach a series on tradition versus truth, y'all will hate me and never have me back. Because there's a lot of things we do in the church that are tradition but not necessarily truth. You got a preacher stands up and says, you know what? Let's not go that direction. It's worldly. What you choose to do in your own family, in your own life, that's what you need the Lord. But if it's going to put our church, if we're going to slap our church's name on the side of it, let's not go that direction. Well, I don't like that. Well, hey, you know what? Are you about unity? Are you about what you like and don't like? See, we get mad and resentful and bitter towards one another when we don't get our way. And this church house is not about your way. It's about his way. And let me say this, and I love you enough to tell you this, and I hope you'll love me for telling you. If you're here this morning and your attitude in Christian service is your way or the highway, then you're not right with the Lord. And you need to ask God to forgive you for that selfishness today. And he will.
He'll cast it as far as from the east as the west. And you start being a submissive servant and get with the program. Amen. Seeing this morning a call
for unity. Jesus' prayer, Paul's pronouncement. But number two, I want you to see correcting this idea of unity. And here's what I mean by this. I want to tell you what it means. If you'll let me talk to you for just a second. Take your Bible, if you will, and turn to 2 Timothy chapter number 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Some of you have this passage memorized. Maybe many of you. First word is all. Somebody once said all means all, and that's all that all means. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. The word there is theopneustos, which means God breathed. God spoke the words. God breathed it out. The Bible tells us in Peter that the Holy Ghost spake to men of God as he moved on them. All scripture is given by inspiration of God, 2 Timothy 3:16, and is profitable for doctrine, that's teaching, for reproof, shows us where we're wrong, for correction in righteousness, shows us how to get right, that we may be perfect, that means spiritually mature, complete, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. What does it mean? It means everything in God's word doctrinally is right. For reproof, when it tells us we're wrong, guess what? We're wrong. For correction, shows us how to get right. And for instruction in righteousness, shows us how to stay right. The word of God must be the foundation of the local church. Guess what? If your constitution contradicts the word of God, the church constitution is wrong. If the deacons, no offense, but if the deacons want to go one way and God's word goes another, the deacons are wrong. If a pastor doesn't lead according to the word of God, the preacher's wrong. It's our only authority for faith and practice. Friend, aren't you glad that you don't answer to the Pope? Aren't you glad that you don't answer to any singular human religious figure? I'm glad that my authority is the word of God. Therefore, when I preach it, I have all the authority and power of heaven behind me. I have Jesus on my side when I preach his word. You may not like it. You may not agree with it. You might fight over it. You may squirm under conviction. But the bottom line is God's word is always true. And therefore, when we compare what God's word has to say to what the current modern day ecumenical church has to say about unity, the definitions are far apart. Number one, let me say this. Unity is not about removing the integrity of the message. If we're removing Bible truth in the name of unity, we'll never have it. You cannot remove what God has placed in eternal stone. It's the foundation. Well, we need to soften up the message. We need to go less preaching and more of a teaching type. We don't have a podium. We have a stage. And friend, nothing is further wrong. Listen, I'm 47 years old. In some people's estimations, I'm still a young man. And by the way, I'll take young man as long as you want to call me that. I got a birthday coming up where I'm going to be 40. That's 2 years closer than 50. I think 50 is a new 30, don't you, brother? We're going to go with that anyway, all right? I'll take young man as long as I can. But when it comes to the preaching of God's word, I'm old-fashioned. And listen, friend, we don't need smoke and mirrors. We don't need lights. We don't need presentations. We don't need rock music. We need the word of God. Amen. Hey, you know what? I'll get an amen from everybody there. Because some of you don't agree with that. And I want to tell you something in truth. You're wrong. Because God doesn't honor what God dishonors. And we can't take worldly whatever, slap a Jesus name on it, and expect God to bless it. He said in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing. Brother Barry, are you a Puritan this morning? Absolutely not. I have inconsistencies in my life. Listen, everybody in this room, you may watch a movie that another brother may not watch.
You might listen to a song that another brother doesn't have on his radio. Whatever it is, we're going to stand before God one day and give an account to him for every choice we ever made. And all of us will give an account to God. Romans 14:12, so that every one of us will give an account of himself to God. The Bible says that. 2 Corinthians 5, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that every man may receive the things done in his body, whether they be good or whether they be bad. We have an appointment day with God coming. But unity is not about removing the integrity of the message. Oh, friends, the church doesn't need gimmicks. It needs the gospel. And by the way, if you're visiting here with us today, let me say this. The most important thing in a church is not the programs they offer. It's the preaching of the Word of God. Amen. If they've got the best programs and the best kids this and the best snacks and the best foo-foo this and fee-fee that, whatever it may be, but they don't preach truth, find another church. Amen. There's no unity there. And the second thing is, do they love people by speaking the truth in love? Somebody once said, you can be as theologically clear as ice and twice as cold. We don't want to be mean-spirited and hateful. We're not here to be jerks for Jesus. Jesus, we can contend for the faith without being contentious. But friend, I want to tell you something. The Word of God has to be preached. Amen. And right now in this transition period, the devil would love nothing more than to infiltrate the little minor micro cracks and lead people astray from the faithful preaching and teaching of the Word of God that your last pastor and those before him faithfully preached and taught. Don't let that happen. Number two, unity is not a removal of individuality. I got a question for you. Do you think Paul had a different personality from Peter? Yes is the answer, all right? Paul was a learned Pharisee. Scholar. Peter would say, Paul's got a heap of book learning. That's what Peter would say. Peter was a fisherman. Rough. Stuck his size 14 sandal in his mouth and chewed vigorously all the time, didn't he? All right? Rough and tumble. Even Peter said later on in the New Testament, some of Paul's writings are hard. Were they on the same page? Overall, yeah. Did they have different upbringings, different parents, different perspectives? You bet. Different preferences? Probably. Paul probably liked Little Caesars and Peter liked Domino's. Peter's wrong, by the way. But they were, listen to me, they were headed same direction. Amos 3:3 says this, how can two walk together except they be agreed? Now, if you've got two people and one of them's a power walker, those people are weird, aren't they? You ever see those people? You know, they walk. Then you got other people saying, oh, Jesus, please help me get through this mile, please. But they're both headed the same direction, right? Important thing is not who's the fastest. Important thing is they're both same direction. Paul said in Philippians that we keep the spirit of unity. Are we headed the same direction this morning? Well, we don't have a new pastor yet. This is my opportunity to get my agenda across. It's not about your agenda. Amen. It's about what thus saith the Lord. We've seen a call for unity. We've seen correcting unity. Now, number three this morning, we'll stop with this. We'll get to the first point, then we're done. I want you to see the characteristics of unity. Take your Bible, if you will, and go to 2 Corinthians chapter number 6. We'll get the first one. If you want to know what the rest of them are, you can come back this evening. 2 Corinthians chapter number 6. I referenced the scripture a moment ago. The number one characteristic of unity in the church is salvation. So, Brother Barry, are you saying that if I'm here today and I'm not a Christian, I shouldn't be here? Absolutely not. We're not saying that. We're glad that you're here. As a matter of fact, you've come to the right place. you're among friends. Well, Brother Barry, people think I've been saved for years, but I'm not. Listen, there is nobody in this church who's going to pull out a clipboard and say, we thought you were saved. Better write that down. No one's going to be like that. If you're here today and you're not saved, you receive Christ by faith today, we rejoice with you as a unit in unity, right? And if you don't feel that way, then maybe you should leave. All right? Salvation is the most important thing. How could two walk together except they be agreed? Number one, here's why. Because the body of Christ is made up of believers. Now listen to me. I don't want to make anybody mad, but this is the truth. Just because you're in church today does not necessarily mean you're in Christ. Being a part of the body of Christ is not equated with attending church. Jesus talks about in the end times separating the sheep from the goats, the wheat from the tares. But right now, in attendance in the local church, there are both wheat, God's people, and tares, those that don't belong to Him, the sheep and the goats. And one day, God's going to separate them. But listen, you know what? You don't have to be a tare. You don't have to be a goat. You can get saved today. You can join God's family. See, not everybody is a child of God. That's a lie of the devil. That's also a lie of the world's definition of unity. Hey, you know what? We're all God's children. We should be getting along because we're all God's children. Friend, that's a lie. God created everybody physically, but He doesn't create you spiritually until you're born again. You were not born a believer. You were born lost in your sin and need of a Savior. We're all in the same boat. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered the world, and death by sin, so that death's passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. That's what Romans 5:12 says. When Adam sinned, it sealed it for the rest of us. We were born that way. And we need to be saved. But the body of Christ is made up of believers. The bride of Christ is saved people. The church of Christ is not a denominational name. It's made up of born-again believers who are going to live forever with Christ. Are you part of that body? Friend, I want to tell you, you'll never understand what unity in Jesus means until you get saved. As a matter of fact, Paul said that the gospel to them that are perishing is foolishness. Maybe you're here today, you hear all this mess, and you're like, man, I don't know about all this stuff. And it just sounds like a fairy tale to you. It sounds like a story of Greek myth. It sounds like a story that weak-minded men made up to make them feel better about themselves because they couldn't accept the fact that they live, they die, and that's it. Friend, if you're here today and you're not saved, that may be your perception of the gospel. And I'll tell you what, it's the perception of a lot of people in this world. It's a made-up story. It's a myth. It's a fairy tale. No, it's the truth of God's word. And I'm banking my eternity on it and basing my life here on earth if it's truth. The body of Christ is made up of believers. But number two, I want you to see this. Believers have no unity in common with unbelievers.
Look what the Bible says here in 2 Corinthians 6, verse 14. We use this verse to talk about marriage, but you know it actually goes much deeper. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Then Paul asks a series of rhetorical questions. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? The answer is none. And what communion hath light with darkness? The answer is no communion. And what concord hath Christ with Belial, with idols? Nothing in common, no fellowship, no partnership, no agreement. Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? The answer is none, 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 and none. Jesus says that we're not to be unequally yoked. Brother, can I shake your hand? I appreciate it. You're a good man. I don't care what your wife says. Pray for unity. I shook his hand. That's a symbol of a partnership, of an agreement, of a fellowship. Being unequally yoked goes beyond marriage. But I'll say this, listen, a Christian, it's never God's will for a Christian to marry an unbeliever. Ever. You don't have to pray about it, put out a fleece. God does not teach missionary marriages in Scripture. Well, maybe if I marry this person, I can lead them to the Lord. Hey, if I date this person, maybe they'll come to Jesus. Listen, you may very well have met somebody who's lost. That person gets saved, and then God brings the two of you together later, and you get married. That can very well happen. But if the person's not saved, that person, at least at that point in time, is not for you. Now, the Bible says if you're married and one spouse is lost, then the believer is not to seek to lead that spouse.
But before marriage, it's never God's will to marry somebody who isn't saved. But you know this word means partnership. A believer ought to go into business with other believers. Your closest friends on earth should be other Christians. You say, Brother Barry, Jesus ate with prostitutes and tax collectors and self-righteous moralists and the dregs of society. Absolutely he did, and he loved them all, and he ate meals with them, but he spent his most intimate moments with his disciples. The Bible says we as Christians, we don't have anything in common with those that are lost. It doesn't mean we're spiritual snobs and we stick our nose in the air until we can tell the texture of the clouds. It doesn't mean that we go around, I'm better than you are, Jesus loves me more. We don't mean any of that nonsense, but it does mean this, I am saved. I'm a child of God, redeemed and cleansed by the blood of God. Therefore, I look at the world different. I see the world different. I look at it through the lens of Scripture. I'm no longer blind. My eyes have been opened. I'm to be separate from the world while living in it. I'm to engage the culture, not embrace the culture. I'm to live separate. I'm not a hermit. I don't separate from everybody. I love people. I witness, but I'm not to partake in what you do. I'm weird. I'm peculiar. I'm a stranger on earth, and you don't understand any of that. That's what we are in Jesus. Amen. And therefore, if you're here today and you're not saved, you need to get with the program. Why don't you join the family of God and experience the unity that comes from being one with other believers? Man, we've got different preferences. We've got different personalities. We even disagree on Scripture. Like my mother, who's in heaven, used to say, son, we're going to get to heaven one day and find out that none of us had it all right. And I believe that. And you know what? God will correct us and we'll say, yes, sir, and we won't argue. And we'll be the better for it. Without salvation, the rest of the characteristics are moot. Are you saved today? Are you on the same page as everyone else in here this room who wants what the Lord wants, who's headed towards heaven, having a relationship with Jesus in the meanwhile? Are you on that narrow path? There is no unity without it. Listen, friends, Satan would love nothing more during this pivotal, crucial time in the history of Pine Grove Missionary Baptist than to blow the whole thing up and to ruin the work of God. Now, we don't have to be fretting. We don't have to be worrying. We don't have to be fatalistic. But we ought to be aware of his tactics and do what we can to the Lord's help individually. Be unified in him. Why don't you pray with me?